If you have a Bible, you want to go to Luke chapter 5, and we're going to look at verses 17 through 26. Luke 5, 17 through 26. Luke's in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It's one of the four Gospels, one of the four biographies of the life of Jesus. If you're not normally a Bible reader and you'd like to start, the Gospels are a great place to kick things off, especially the new year. You know, with a new year, it's new opportunities. People make New Year's resolutions. I'd say don't make a New Year's resolution. Just say, hey, I'm going to do something and start doing it. And so if you've never read your Bible before or not a regular reader of it, I'd start with maybe John or go Matthew, Mark, Luke, anywhere of those places. But you really to know about Jesus and his life, that's a great place to start. Luke chapter 5, verses 17 through 26, and we'll read that in just a second. Well, so the question is, did you get everything you wanted for Christmas? No, little kid over here, no. I didn't get that place at the having the delivery room playset, and so I know that's not what she said, but I couldn't really understand, or what they, but I could, I think it's about animals, I think is what she said. Anyway, but I gotta Google that up after this is over. Okay, so maybe you didn't get everything, but did you get, hopefully you got at least one thing that you were wanting for Christmas. I hope so. But here's a better question. Was anyone disappointed by what you got for Christmas? And don't answer that out loud, because the person that gave it to you may be right next to you. I don't watch a lot of the Kimmels and the Jimmy Fallons. If I do, I'll watch it on YouTube the next day or something. But one of the things that Kimmel does, he does it in Halloween with candy, but then he also asks people to do it at Christmas too. And what he does is he asks parents to give their kids like horrible Christmas gifts, kind of like fake Christmas gifts, and then videotape them and send them in, and he shows them. And you should go to YouTube and watch it. It's kind of crazy. But they're horrible things. They're things that kids would never want, like a potato or a half-eaten sandwich or deodorant or a hammer or a sponge. And it's hilarious, but it's also a little bit frightening and troubling by the way these kids react. I mean, some of these kids, I mean, they just go off. I mean, they're so angry and they're just crying. But anyway, the kids are extremely disappointed, and they're not afraid to show their disappointment. I remember one Christmas when I was in elementary school, way back when, and my parents, not all the time, but sometimes my parents would let us open up a gift on Christmas Eve and open up one early. And so, you know, as a kid, you've been waiting to open up gifts what feels like forever, since, you know, weeks before when that first gift that had your name on it appeared underneath the tree. So there's this a lot of excitement, there's a lot of anticipation, a lot of buildup, and then they finally let you open up one. And it was never ever the big gift, right? It was never the if you do the Santa gift or whatever you do in your home, it was never the big one. It was something a little bit smaller. But as a kid, you're just excited. But it was usually a fun gift, something that we could play with. But I remember this one year, my mom gave us one to open up. And again, you're a kid, and your whole life has just been just wrapped around opening up these presents, and your expectations are just like, you know, just through the roof. And so when I opened it up, it was a pair of homemade pajamas. Yeah, that's exactly what I did. Ugh. Okay, it was a homemade pajamas, but you're gonna feel bad when I tell you who made them. From my grandmother. Oh, well, see, I still was like, ugh. You know, because and so adult Jimmy sees the value in that gift and understands the hard work that went into that gift, because my grandmother had a lot of grandkids. I think there was if I count right, there's eight siblings, including my mom, on that side of the family. And so and we're a Hispanic family, and so there's lots of cousins. Matter of fact, we just came back from a Christmas reunion, family reunion that we do every year. And there are lots of us. And so adult Jimmy knows that my grandmother put a lot of hard work into that to make those homemade pajamas. But elementary school Jimmy, he did not consider any of that, nor did little Jimmy care about any of that. So I was not happy with the pair of blue homemade PJs. But I did know this. I didn't know a lot in elementary school, but I did know this, not to express my disappointment in front of my mom, but especially in front of my dad. So I went to my room with a smile on my face and then began to express my disappointment. But you know, it's all that buildup, all that excitement, and then your expectations are just, it's just shattered. And you're like, PJs? So I looked up the definition of disappointment or something being disappointing, and Webster says it's failing to meet expectations. And so here's a silly question. Have you ever experienced disappointment? Let's see, where do we start? We've been disappointed by a meal that we've had. We've probably been disappointed by a movie we went and saw, by a TV show, by customer service that we've experienced, by our internet speed, by our airline, by your favorite sports team. Maybe you were disappointed when you came in here and saw that it was. You know, somebody besides Chad up here is preaching. You've been disappointed because you didn't get the raise. You were disappointed because you didn't get the promotion or you didn't get the job. You've been disappointed because you didn't make the right grade that you thought you were going to get. You didn't make the team. You didn't get picked for the project. You didn't get the class that you wanted or the professor or the teacher that you wanted. Some of you have experienced even deeper disappointments. Disappointments maybe in relationships, in your marriage, in your health. And some of us, me included, I would say, some of us would even say we've been disappointed by God. He didn't act fast enough. He didn't act the way that we'd hoped he would. We didn't get the answer that we wanted. And disappointment, unfortunately, it's just a part of our lives. It's just going to happen. And just to prove my point here, and I'm not asking you to say which kind of disappointment, but just raise your hand if you've ever been disappointed in your life. Just raise your hand. Yeah. So most of us, if not all of us. But here's the thing. I think you can do two things with disappointment, and this is it. So after you hear this, you can leave. You can let it stop you, or you can let it start you. Can let it stop you, or you can let it start you. People look at disappointment sometimes and all they see is just a failure. Whether it's a failure on their part, they're disappointed because they didn't do how they expected they would do, or it's a failure because someone else didn't meet our expectations. And when all you see is failure, then you're not going to move forward. You're not going to keep going. You're just going to stop. And chances are you'll probably quit. But your other option with disappointment is not to just see failure, but to seize an opportunity to grow in faith. When you view disappointment as an opportunity to grow in faith, then you're going to move on. You're going to move forward. You're going to learn. You're going to reevaluate. You'll adjust your vision. You're going to adjust your perspective. And then you're going to start all over again. And that choice, either to stop or to start, it can make all the difference in whether you live with joy, you live with peace, you live with contentment, and you live with purpose. To stop says, I give up. To start says, well, let's try again. Let's try something different. And this morning, I want to look at a familiar story. Some of you probably already looked ahead, but it's in the New Testament there in Luke's gospel. And it's a story of disappointment followed by an act of faith. And I want us to see what we can learn as we talk about transforming disappointment to faith. But again, it's Luke chapter 5, verses 17 through 26, I believe. It says, on one of those days, while he was teaching, this is Jesus, while Jesus was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and also from Jerusalem. And the Lord's power to heal was in him, was in Jesus. Just then some men came carrying on a stretcher a man who was paralyzed. They tried to bring him in and set him down before him. Since they could not find a way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on the stretcher through the roof tiles into the middle of the crowd before Jesus. Verse 20, seeing their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Then the scribes and the Pharisees began to think to themselves, "Who is this man who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And what's crazy is this, is they were thinking this, but then watch, Jesus calls them on what they were thinking. But perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, "Why are you thinking this in your hearts?" I'm sure that freaked them out. Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, get up and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he told the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, take up your stretcher, and go home." Immediately he got up before them, picked up what he had been lying on, and went home glorifying God. Then everyone was astounded, and they were giving glory to God, and they were filled with awe. And he said, "We have seen incredible things today." You can imagine this scene, right? Jesus' reputation had caught the attention of the Pharisees and teachers of the law. These guys were the religious leaders, and their motives were not pure, because they'd heard Jesus' teaching and they wanted to stop it because he was claiming to be someone that they couldn't believe that he was who he said he was, to be the Son of God. So he was going to stop it. And a whole lot of other people have caught on to this wave of what's happening, what Jesus is doing. By this point in Luke's gospel, he's done quite a bit of teaching. He's quite a lot of healing. He's done miracles. So it makes sense that when people hear that Jesus is coming into their town, coming into their area, that he's close by, that they're going to do whatever they can to come and see him. So where Jesus goes, a crowd usually follows, or it quickly gathers. In this house, it was jam-packed. This account is in a couple of other gospels. There are people everywhere, and there's absolutely no more room in this house. There's just no space. There's no room to spare. Some guys had heard that Jesus was there in town, so they brought a man who was paralyzed. Okay, he couldn't walk, and because of his condition, there's a good chance that this man, he probably had never worked. He couldn't move around on his own. And you can imagine, I don't know that we can, but can you imagine being in that condition in Jesus's time? Being paralyzed in biblical times, there weren't any wheelchairs, there weren't any rehab hospitals, there weren't any modifications done to buildings or to anything. There were no special medicines. If you were paralyzed, you were stuck. Your life would be reduced to just begging for things, depending upon other people. You'd hope that someone would have compassion on you to give you money so that you could buy something, or hopefully they would bring you food. If you knew that Jesus was in town and you wanted to get to him, you couldn't. And I imagine that this man's life, he lived his life kind of just drowning in disappointment. The what ifs and the what could be's and what might have been. And there's a good chance that the people who walked by him on a daily basis really saw no hope for him as well. They just probably felt bad. And I'm sure there was probably some judgment, because we see in other parts of Scripture where people are making judgments about people because of the sickness or the illness that they have. You know, maybe they were asking things like, did he sin? Was it something that his parents did that he is the way that he is? No job, probably not much family, not many friends, and it's a good bet that he probably had zero status in the community. So you can imagine what people thought about him, but also what he thought about himself. But then there are these guys. They're not named. And were they his friends? Maybe. Good chance. Did they know him? Yeah, probably. What was it about them that caused them to pick this guy up and bring him to Jesus? Why didn't they, probably like everyone else, just give up on this guy or just walk by this guy? Because he'd probably given up on himself. But in this text, I think we see some important things, four things that I think that are key to moving from this idea of disappointment to moving to faith. And these are in your outline if you want to follow along and take notes. And the first one is this, is that faith takes you to Jesus. Faith is going to take you to Jesus. You know why these guys took this paralyzed man to Jesus? Because they knew Jesus could do something about it. No one else could do anything about it. Nothing else was going to change this situation. Nothing was going to make this better, but they knew Jesus was. And if something was going to change, if something was going to be different, they were going to take him to Jesus, because they knew with Jesus, things are never hopeless. With Jesus, there is always opportunity. With Jesus, there's power to change lives, to change circumstances, to change hearts, and even to change minds. Philippians chapter 4, verses 12 and 13 says, I have experienced times of need. This is Paul talking, who wrote this. I've experienced times of need and times of abundance. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of contentment, whether I go satisfied or hungry, have plenty or nothing. And by now, you should be leaning in, okay? Because he's learned the secret of contentment. So we lean in and we look in verse 13. And here's the secret. I'm able to do all things through the one who strengthens me. Through Jesus. Disappointment. Here's the deal. Disappointment, if you let it, will take you to despair. It'll take you to hopelessness. It'll take you to fear. It'll take you to unhealthy anger. It will make you want to give up. But faith takes you to Jesus because you know that Jesus can help you face anything. Some of you know this, but maybe not all of you, but Paul, when he wrote Philippians, he wrote this letter, and you listen to these verses, he was in prison when he wrote this. And not in minimum security prison, not in this country club prison. I mean, he was in prison. He was chained. He was alone. It was dark. It was gross. He was stuck. He was in prison. And I want to point that out because I didn't want you to think that Paul wrote this from the beach, you know, from some resort or from some mansion where God had blessed his obedience and his life was perfect. I don't want you to know. I want to point that out because here's the thing. God doesn't always change our circumstances. Paul didn't write that from a place of luxury, a place of comfort. Paul wrote that in prison. You see, God doesn't always change our circumstances, but what he does is he changes us. He changes us. He changes our hearts. He changes our minds. He changes our perspective. He changes our outlook. I don't want you to hear me say that God's going to fix all your problems and you'll never struggle again. That's not truth. That's not gospel. That's man-made. But God promises his presence and his power to face whatever it is that we're going through. And these guys knew that Jesus would change things for this man. Okay, I don't know if they thought that he would walk again, but they knew that if they got him to Jesus, that things would be different. Philippians 4:19, later in that chapter, it says, "My God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus." Faith takes us to Jesus because we know that even in the midst of disappointment, God will give us exactly what we need. And he won't use your resources. And he won't use my resources. He will pull from his vast riches and his vast power. Faith takes you to Jesus because in Jesus there is always hope. Second thing there I want to tell you is that faith is not limited by circumstances. This is not anything new to you. Or maybe it is, I don't know. But this is something we need to be reminded of. Faith is not limited by circumstances. I'm not exactly sure how far these men had to walk to bring this guy, but I'm pretty sure it wasn't an easy journey carrying this man to where Jesus was. And when they get there, what do they see? Do they see a clear path to Jesus? Do they see Jesus just kind of standing there waiting for them to come? No. They see a crowded house with literally no way to get to Jesus. No way inside. And I'm sure at that moment there was disappointment. I'm sure at that moment there was frustration. There may have even been a little bit of, well, this was just a giant waste of time. It would have been easy to give up. It would have been easy to go back. They could have just said, you know what, let's just sit and wait here and hope that when the crowds go, that maybe he'll come out or we'll have a chance to see him. It would have been easy because that's exactly what their circumstances dictated, right? Circumstances said there's no way to get to Jesus. And that's how a lot of us, we fall trapped to our circumstances. That, look, crowded, we can't. The door is closed. We can't do this. Circumstances say there's no way. circumstances say it's not happening. It would have been easy to give up because that's what their circumstances dictated. Their circumstances told them, you're out of luck. You're too late. Better luck next time. And you can imagine what's going through the guy who's paralyzed, what's going through his mind. It's just one more frustration, one more disappointment, and a long line of frustration and disappointment in his life. And what hope he had, if he had any, now was gone because there was no way for him to get to Jesus. And I wonder if he maybe even looked up at the guys and just said, just take me back. Just take me back. And you couldn't blame him because in his mind, based on circumstances, it was over. And that's what disappointment does. It makes you think it's over. It's never going to get, maybe you've said this, it's never going to get better. It's never going to change. It will always be like this. I'm always destined to come up short. I've always feel this way. I'll always be lonely. I'll always be a failure. I'll never be good enough. It's never, ever going to change for me. And by the way, just so you know, those thoughts aren't from God. So when you hear those, don't follow those because those aren't from God. That's our minds focused on a perceived reality that has forgotten that we serve a heavenly Father who is capable of anything and who is not limited by circumstances. And again, who can blame you? Who can blame me? Who can blame them? Circumstances looked like there was no way. It will always be this way. But that's not God. Our faith tells us to go, to keep going. And that's exactly what these guys did. Scripture doesn't say how long it took them. Like, it doesn't say when they walked up, did they immediately go, oh, I got another idea? Or did they sit there and they were just kind of frustrated, kind of, well, what do we do? Do we go back? You know, it's we're tired. You know, what? But they decided that the house was full. I mean, they saw that the house was full, and so they decided, you know what we're going to do? We're going to go up. We'll go up. And that's exactly what they did. Circumstances told them they're done, but their faith told them, look up. Go up. Joshua 1:9 says this, this is my command, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. When God said these words to Joshua, if you don't know the background, Joshua is about to lead the people of Israel into the promised land. Joshua had been Moses' helper, and Moses had led the people to the promised land, didn't get to go in because of the people's disobedience, because of their sin. So Moses has to lead the people. They're wandering in the desert for 40 years until that unbelieving generation died off, and Moses is about to go in, take the people in. Moses makes a mistake. God allows him to see it, but doesn't allow him to go in. And so Joshua now, it's his job to go into the promised land. And oh, by the way, this promised land is still occupied. So it's not like a hotel room where you walk in and it's clean and it's waiting for you. No one else is in there. There are people that still live in this land. It's these people think it belongs to them. So they're going to have to go in where it's occupied. They're going to have to go into a land, and people aren't just going to lay down and say, okay, well, here's the keys to our homes. Here's the key to our land. No, they're going to have to go in and fight. They're going to have to go in and battle. And God says, you're going to win, but you're going to have to go in and you're going to fight for it. So circumstances, again, and if you've read in any of the Old Testament, you know a lot about these people. These weren't just nobodies. These were warriors. These were giants. These were some mean people who could defend their territory. Circumstances said, Joshua, you might want to rethink this, but God said this to Joshua. And he says this to you and to me, be strong and courageous. Because you can do it. No, he didn't say that. He said, be strong and courageous because you're awesome. No, he didn't say that either, did he? He said, be strong and courageous because you are better than everyone else. No. He said, be strong and courageous because I'm with you. I'm with you. Ephesians 3:20 says, now glory be to God who by his mighty power at work within us is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or even dream of, infinitely beyond our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, or hopes. And that's exactly why we never stop when God is saying go. God can do far more than we would ever dream to ask of or even dare to ask of. God sees. Here's the thing. God sees what we don't see. God knows what we don't know. God is working in ways that we don't understand or we can't even comprehend. And to let disappointment keep you from moving forward, then what you're doing is you're just negating all the possibilities that God has at his disposal. So to let disappointment stop you is basically saying, no, there's nothing more that can be done. But there's a God, hey, remember me? Remember me? Here's a truth, and it can be a scary truth, but the only thing that can stop God from moving in your life is you. The only thing that can stop God from moving in your life is you. The third thing there I want to share with you is that faith can get messy. Faith can just get messy. Jewish homes, they often had these stairs on the outside of their homes. So that's where these guys more than likely would have gone up. That's what they would have seen. The roofs were flat so that people could go up on top. And there's that would be another room, kind of an open air room, but also in the heat of the season, they could go up on top and sleep. And so this is where these men more than likely are headed up with this pallet that they have, the paralyzed man. Luke kind of just summarizes the passage we read. He kind of just summarizes what they did here. But this account in Mark goes into a little bit greater detail. And Mark says that they removed the roof and dug an opening. And so as I said, the roof was flat, and most likely it's made of timbers that are covered with sticks and mud and laid over with some kind of rock. I don't know, think tile or something, but just rocks covered so people could be on there. It had to be strong enough for people to be up there to stand on. So to get through, they're going to have to lift up these rocks. They're going to have to dig through the sticks and this dried mud. So this is more than likely causing a scene. And as you can imagine, this would have been a little bit of a disturbance from everything that was going on below inside the house. And I don't know if Jesus kept going. I don't know what that scene was like. You know, just kind of maybe some stuff started falling on his head, or you know, things started falling down, or you know, maybe the room was a little bit dark, and then you start seeing a little bit of ray, a light kind of coming through where they're digging a hole. I don't know what he did. I kind of, just knowing Jesus' ability to perceive things, I kind of think maybe just in my imagination that he stops and he sits back and he watches it, and probably even with a little bit of a smile, because he knows what's happening. I'm not sure the owner of the home was smiling, but I love that these guys weren't afraid to get dirty, weren't afraid to do whatever was necessary, because this was not proper etiquette. You don't go on someone's roof and remove it to invite yourself in. But these guys weren't afraid to kind of stir things up. These guys weren't afraid to get a little dirty, a little messy, so that they could get this guy to Jesus. And that's the application here, is faith isn't always nice and clean. Faith is going to cost us. It's going to cost us something. Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25 says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came, the streams rose, the winds blew, and it beat against the house. It beat against the house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundations on the rock." The fact that this house, that its foundation was on the rock, it didn't prevent it from experiencing the storms. It still experienced the storms. Just because we're faithful doesn't mean that things aren't going to get messy. Faith means that you have to keep working at your marriage, even when others might be telling you, hey, it's just time to quit. Just let it go. It's just disappointment after disappointment. Just stop. But faith says, you know, I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to stop at what God brought together. I'm not going to give that up. Faith means that you might have to step away from a friendship that's distracting you or pulling you away from God, even though you care about that person deeply. Faith means that you may have to change jobs or change cities, even though you love where you are. Faith means that you may have to risk comfort so that you can put yourself in a better place to help others. Faith means that you may have to rearrange your calendar to take some things off so that you have time for other things, for God-type things, even though you feel like everything on your calendar is super necessary. Faith means that you may have to deal with emotional scars or clean out some emotional baggage that you've just been afraid of what that might mean for you. Faith may mean that you have to have a difficult conversation with someone that you've been putting off. Faith may mean that you have to actually walk across the street and meet your neighbor and have a relationship, try to develop a relationship. Faith may mean that you have to share your faith, even though you're worried that sharing that might make things a little bit uncomfortable. Faith may mean that you might need to turn your finances over to God and say, God, I've been living my life just however I want to, but what do you want me to do with what you've blessed me with? You see, faith isn't easy, and faith isn't always nice and clean and wrapped up with a little bow. Sometimes it gets messy. Sometimes faith, it costs us. Faith means letting go of control and surrendering your life to God, even though it feels safer and better when we hang on to it. 2 Corinthians 12:9-10 says, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, I will most gladly boast all the more about my weaknesses. When's the last time you boasted about your weaknesses? Boast all about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may reside in me. So I take pleasure in weakness. Listen to his words. I take pleasure in weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and in difficulties. That sounds messy. That doesn't sound clean. That doesn't sound nice wrapped up with a bow. Weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and in difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am what? Strong. Say that again. Strong. Messy doesn't bother God, just by the way. That's why I don't necessarily think that Jesus was mad or Jesus was offended. And that's just pure conjecture on my part. I don't know. But I think he knew the heart, and he saw that these guys were willing to get messy so that their friend could get to him. Don't let disappointment keep you from getting dirty. And finally, don't put away things yet. I know this is the last point, but don't put your stuff away, because I don't want you to miss this. Faith changes lives. Faith changes lives. I love that Jesus, he not only noticed the faith of the paralyzed man, but he noticed the faith of the guys that brought him. Their faith, listen to this, their faith, their trust, their reliance, their obedience, their willingness to keep going led this man's sins to be forgiven. Okay, this man was spiritually healed because of their faith, and it also led for this man to be able to walk. He was physically healed too. Now imagine what would have happened if these guys had quit when they saw the crowd. Imagine what it would have cost this paralyzed man. It not only would have cost him his ability to walk, but it would have cost him his ability to spend eternity with Christ in heaven. Because these guys were faithful, it changed the life of this man in incredible ways. Disappointment says, stop. It's over. Quit trying. What are you doing? That doesn't make sense. Just quit. But faith says, we've got to do whatever it takes because there's too much at stake. There's too much at stake. Their faith in Jesus brought this man to Jesus. James 2:17 says, so too faith, if it does not have works to back up that faith, if it does not have works, is by itself dead. Means inoperative, ineffective. It's not enough to say, I believe. All of us could stand up here right now and say, I believe. It doesn't take faith to say, I believe. Anyone can say that. We have to act on it. We have to act on our faith. And it's not enough to say, I believe, as long as things are good, then I'm out. Because that's how a lot of us do it. God, you're in charge. Until I don't like where you're going, then I'm out. Then I'm taking control again. We have to be faithful in all circumstances. 1 Corinthians 15:10 says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. I love what Paul says there. He says it was not without effect. In other words, God's grace, it changed me. It affected me. It changed how I lived. It changed what I did. It changed what I said. It had this profound effect on Paul's life. And because of that, Paul, what he did for the rest of his life was taking the good news of Jesus Christ to the world. And Paul, he never let disappointment stop him. And by the way, in case you've forgotten, Paul experienced disappointment. And he was nice enough to write it down for us. Here's things Paul experienced. He says, I've worked harder, but put in prison more often, been whipped times without number, faced death again and again. 5 different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Okay, and that was not drug-induced. That was where people threw rocks at you. Okay, 3 times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent a whole night and day adrift at sea. Can you imagine? 24 hours just adrift, hanging on to something at sea. I've traveled on many long journeys. I've faced danger from rivers and from robbers. I've faced danger from my own people, the Jews, as well as the Gentiles. I have faced danger in the cities, in the deserts, and on the seas. I've faced danger from men who claim to be believers but are not. I have worked hard and long, enduring many sleepless nights. I've been hungry and thirsty and have often gone without food. I've shivered in the cold without enough clothing to keep warm. And at this point, I'm like, okay, Paul, stop. Stop. I get it. But in the midst of all of that, Paul never stopped. And I'm pretty sure there were times when he was experiencing all that stuff where he wanted to say, okay, I'm good. You know, in football, when you're ready to come out, you kind of tap on your helmet and say, hey, send someone else in. You know, I'm pretty sure Paul may have done this a few times. Like, God, is there anyone else? I'm good. Done. Take a break. Pause. But he didn't. Why? Well, because it was Paul. He's Superman. No. Because he was super Christian. Jimmy, he wrote most of the New Testament. That wasn't it either. The reason Paul never quit in the face of disappointment was because he put his faith, all of it, he put all his faith, all his trust, all his hope, all of his life in God's hands. Disappointment's going to tell you to stop. Faith says, let's start. And I pray that we will be a people who are willing to do whatever it takes to get our community to Jesus. But before we can take our community to Jesus, we need to make sure that we've let God take a hold of us. Because you know what? We can only take a community so far. And we can't take them to Christ if we haven't let Christ take a hold of us. And so what I would say to you and I is, let's go. Let's go.